the resurrection. We know that Easter is known as the resurrection, the day that Jesus came up from the tomb. He arose. It may be called Easter Sunday. It may be called Resurrection Sunday. But you know, as we talk about the resurrection and we speak about Jesus coming up from the tomb, going down to hell, delivering and taking the keys from Satan. Did you know that Jesus' resurrection is your resurrection? What do you mean by that, Pastor? You see, it's not a resurrection unless it affects you. What do you mean by that? Jesus came to give you a new life. He came to help you. He came to give you a new start. Jesus, they crucified him. He was dead and buried, but he came up again. You know, I was reading in the book of Matthew this week. We know that the four Gospels include the resurrection story, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. I chose Matthew this morning because it gives us an understanding about the resurrection from Matthew's perspective. I want to read a few verses here. We're talking about the resurrection. We're not going to be long, 15 minutes, but the resurrection story is about Jesus resurrecting, coming forth, being new life. But did you know that the resurrection story is also about you and your family? It's about you coming forth. But let's read these scriptures here. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. When the chief priests had met with the elders and devised a plan, they gave the soldiers a large sum of money, telling them, "You are to say," I want to skip down to verse 18, we couldn't fit it all on there, but then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, and surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age." This account of the resurrection of Jesus by Matthew has something significant for you this morning. What does Jesus' resurrection look like? There are some verses there. What does your resurrection look like? What do you mean, Pastor? What does your coming forth? What does some seasons where you felt like you were dry, nothing was happening? What does new life look like for you? What does this spring 2019 look like for you and your family? What does the rebirthing look like for you as you're looking for a new start? As you're looking for God to help you to give you a breakthrough, what does that mean to you this morning? What does resurrection look like for you and your life? Thank you for asking. I picked out four things in this text this morning that I thought would be applicable to you and I. It is the story of the resurrection of Jesus, but I've said it several times now, but it's also your resurrection story. It's about you coming back to life. It's about you having a new start. It's about you being born again in some respects. It's about once you were lost, but now you're found. The first thing I pick up here in the scripture, it says after the Sabbath. What does that mean for you and I? You know, it's after that sometimes God begins to work. After the Sabbath, at the dawn of the first day, Jesus says, Pastor Joel said it very well this morning, there was a Friday before there was a Sunday. And the scriptures are very clear. It says, after the Sabbath, that's when Jesus came from the tomb. What does that look like for you and me? It's after the sacrifice. It's after the worship. It's after they came to a service like this it was the Sabbath, possibly it was on a Saturday, and maybe the Sunday would be the first day of the week of their calendar. But it was after the Sabbath, after they came and they gave to God their time, they set apart the first fruits of their life. It was after the Sabbath that the resurrection occurred. I'm here to tell you this morning that there's a formula a little bit to your resurrection. There's a way that you're going to break forth. It may not just happen casually. It's going to be predetermined. Jesus made a decision to go to the cross. It's after the Sabbaths. It's after the sacrifice. It's after they gave of themselves. It's after, it's not only that, it was also after the hurt, the pain. It was after the betrayal. The scripture tells in Isaiah that he was betrayed. You know when your resurrection is going to come? After you've been hurt. After you've been bruised. The Bible says that he was bruised. He was a bruised reed. After you're feeling the sting of someone hurting you. What does your resurrection look like this morning? What does your coming forth out from your grave look like? You see, Easter 2019 is not going to be significant unless you're a part of it. What do you mean by that, Pastor? Unless you have that resurrection and you are revived. God wants to revive you. God wants to help you to get back on track. God wants you to break forth. He came up from the grave. He wants you to come up from your grave. The loss, the pain, the things that bit him, he wants you to be free from those things. So Jesus was bruised for our transgressions. Some of you have been through a lot. You've been hurt. You've been feel like you've been cheated in some way. You feel like someone betrayed you. You thought they were with you, and then something happened. Oh, maybe it was their fault, your fault. Who knows? But you understand that. Jesus understood that. Pastor Joel said, you got to have Friday before you have Sunday. You got to have after the Sabbath. Certain things have to happen in your life in order for you to experience what God has for you. You got to go through some things. What do you mean? You got to go through the pain, the hurt. You got to go through being alone. Jesus was alone in the garden. He knew what it was for those closest to him to fall asleep. We're not blaming the disciples this morning. We're all human. We all make mistakes. Everyone in this congregation does. Jesus didn't blame them. He was hoping that they would be with them during his darkest hour. But it was after the hurt, the loss, after you've been through something that you don't know how you got there, is when God is going to help you get to the next level. And quickly, I see here that the resurrection came about after the Sabbath, after you give. Listen, I truly believe by you putting God first this morning, that maybe the midnight hour tonight, you're going to have a breakthrough. It was after the Sabbath, after your Sabbath here, after you fellowship with some people, after you give of your time, after you do devotion to God. It was after the dedication, after they're giving God. Well, Pastor, I barely made it here. I'm with you. I don't bring a lot to the table this morning. No, you bring yourself. God's not looking for a lot. He's just looking for you to be available. It was after the Sabbath that there was a breakthrough. Here, I want you to be anticipating tomorrow. Remember this tomorrow, this point as we move on to the second one, that maybe God has something for you. Be expecting your breakthrough to take place, your resurrection. Be expecting God to do something in your life. The second quick thing, there was a violent earthquake. What do you mean by that? A lot of times, we feel something moving or shaking under our feet, and it's hard for us to understand or comprehend. It says here that it was after the Sabbath. Then verse 2, it says there was a violent earthquake. What does your resurrection look like? What does God working in your life look like? Here, when Jesus was resurrected, there was a violent earthquake. And I suppose the resurrection that he experienced is similar to the resurrection that is going about to happen in your life. A violent earthquake? There's tremblings going on in your life. You get fearful. You could read the scriptures, and we only threw up one there for this point. But there is fear. Many didn't know what was going on. Some of you don't know what is going on in your life. You're feeling tremors. There's some uncertainties as things are shifting underneath you. And you're kind of wondering, what does this mean in my life, at this stage in my life? There's tremors going on. You're grabbing hold. You're not sure if this is something good or whatever is happening in my life. But may I say that the earthquake was nothing more than God moving towards, the angels moving towards Jesus. May I say the earthquake, not only the violent earthquake that you're experiencing, is nothing more than God moving towards you. What do you mean? The uncertainties. Feeling like you're out of control. You don't know where it's heading. You don't know what's going on in your life. The violent earthquakes where you're trying to find security. Maybe that's nothing more this morning of God moving towards you. It says the angel of God came and moved towards the tomb. You know, the angel of God is nothing more than God moving towards you. The angel of God was nothing more than God sending his awareness and his help. Listen, to the tomb. What dead things in your life that God is sending towards you right now, and you're looking at it as some kind of negative? You're looking at the crisis or the tremors, the violent earthquake going on in your life that others around you are experiencing also. Wondering what's this all about? And they can't put words to it. It says that they were terrified. Sometimes we're fearful when God begins to do something in your life. Don't worry about the trembling. Don't worry about those things that are being shaken. Maybe the shift that's being taken place right now is God working towards your life. Some of you are wanting definition to what's going on in your life. Some of you wanting to transcribe it in some way. Wanting you to somehow put definition to what you're feeling. Once you're experiencing, it's like a violent earthquake. We're talking about your resurrection this morning. This is the resurrection. But it's also your resurrection, how God is working in your life. And we see that there was a violent earthquake, for the angel of the Lord came down from heaven. Oh, God's moving towards you. What? So I can look at this as God rescuing me? God's about to break forth something good? It says here, he came from heaven and going towards the tomb. Some of you had some dead things in your life that you needed revived. Maybe it's a relationship. Maybe it's some kind of career move. You need something to break forth. You need something to come forth from that dead thing that you experienced. And you don't understand. It's hard for you to put there's fear. It says here that that's nothing more than God moving towards you. I want to tell you that what is going on in your life is nothing more than God rescuing you. And you're looking at it as a negative. You're looking at those insecurities as something you can't understand, but it's nothing more than God rushing toward you to bring you forth from the tomb, from those dead things. The third quick thing here. When the chief priests had met with the elders and devised a plan, we're talking about the resurrection again. We're talking about your resurrection. What does your resurrection look like? It's others devising a plan to keep you back. Here's what happened here. It's seeing that Jesus, the angels moved towards, maybe it was Gabriel, maybe it was Michael, they're moving towards the tomb. The angel of God, which is God himself, moving towards you, helping you. You can be sure that God is helping you. Then it says here that when others started to see, wow, that the tremors going on in your life, the instabilities were nothing more than God helping you, they started to get a little worried that you're going to be released. You're going to break forth. People around you started to think, what? I thought I had him. I thought I had Jesus in hell. And the tremors were nothing more than God working in behalf of the people. We see clearly here that the devised plan. Now, what does this mean for you and I? Did you know that some people are trying to hold you back? What do you mean? The world doesn't want you to win. Did you know that the world wants to keep you from becoming all that God had you to be? Jesus arose now at this point. And here's what it says, that they devised a plan. Did you know that Satan has devised a plan to keep you and your family from becoming all that God has? What do you mean by that? The Bible says that he shoots darts and arrows to you on a regular basis as schemes against you. The devil doesn't want you to be free. Think about if you got a hold of this God thing. Think about if this resurrection became real for you. Think about if resurrection became a part of your family. You can become more than you ever thought could happen in your life. And the enemy doesn't like it. Listen, Jesus went to the grave, the tomb. It says that he went to hell. We saw the video there. And Satan thought he won. Satan thought, and Pastor Joel said it, don't start the party now. You don't know what it means. But here's what happened. The devising of the plan was nothing more than Satan trying to hold on to Jesus. Here's what happened. The religious leaders of the day didn't want it to be effective. Did you know what God is doing in your life? Satan doesn't want it to be effective. Did you know that if you became effective, if the real thing, here's what happened. He rose up, but they said, they started to make up stories. They said, listen, just say that someone robbed the grave. That's what the devising of the plan. Just say that he really wasn't arose. The Pharisees and Sadducees, they said, just devise a plan. They gave some money. They said, put this, you know, just keep telling everybody that really it didn't happen. And then it started being told over and over. Did you know that there's people today that don't believe that Jesus is real, that came forth? Satan is trying to deceive the world. Did you know that the enemy is trying to deceive what God is doing in your life? That's why you got to be smarter than the enemy. You got to rise up above. Satan has devised a plan. You were once on drugs. He's trying to get you to get back on drugs, trying to hurt you. He's devised a plan. The question is, are you going to fall for it? That's why we have a congregation like this. Sure, maybe not as big as others, but we're a family of God. Why? Because when two stand together, we can put the enemy to flight more. We're nothing more than the body of Christ. We're linked with them, and we're linked with other churches here in Arlington Heights, whatever. If you're part of the church, it's the worldwide church of God. Whoever calls on the name of the Lord, whatever stripes they are. So we stand together against the forces of the enemy. Your time here this morning is about the best thing you could do to thwart off the division that Satan is throwing your way. Satan wants to destroy your family. God wants to save your family. Satan wants to devise things against you so that you never become the person that God intended you to be. Are you going to allow him to? Or are you going to say, I know the trickeries. I have been raised. I'm going to go forth and become all that God has for me. The last quick thing, as I saw about what's this resurrection mean for you and I? What does this mean? We point out some points here, the resurrection of Jesus. But the fourth thing was, therefore go and make disciples. What I saw here was, and this is the end of the chapter, the end verse of chapter 28. You see, the Great Commission was part of the resurrection. That's where we're losing it a little bit today. You know, we're about ourselves and we wonder why that we're unhappy. We're about gaining for ourselves and we wonder why we don't have the peace. You see, Jesus transferred immediately from the resurrection into the Great Commission. And here's where I think we're missing it today, where we're always trying to satisfy ourselves and we're never content. We're on this and that, and we're trying to, and Jesus said, resurrection is about the Great Commission. Break that down for me, Pastor. Help me know, what do you mean by that? Jesus says, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations. Right before that, he said, all authority in heaven and earth is given to me. I kind of want to work for someone where he has all the marbles and he holds the keys of life. I kind of think I want to be on that person's side. He says, all authority has been given to me. Now, therefore, go and make disciples. And surely I'll be with you to the end of the age. That tells me that we better be about the Father's business. You want me to tell you? You want to get happy? You want purpose in your life? Do something for Jesus. Why are we thinking about this gas station? I know it sounds, when I think about it, sometimes I think it sounds crazy. When I kind of, you know, thought of the idea. But you know what? You know what it's about? How we could reach people and help people? That's nothing more than that. It's not about more land. It's about, can we be a glass of cold water to a single mom, a single dad, and the elderly? Someone driving through town that maybe got in a fight with someone and they took off and they're about running out of gas, where we could be and pray with them. Where we can help the community in somehow, where the police department, our clergy association, we regularly give out and help people, but somehow where we can be a vessel where people can send and we could be a blessing to people. I don't know if giving out wiper blades a couple times a year is a good thing, but maybe changing oil for someone or helping, I don't know. Here's what I want to say. Find God's purpose in your life and you'll be content. And you may not have all the money. You may not have everything. But Jesus said resurrection is about the Great Commission. I remember when I was pastoring a little church and seems like that's what I pastored all my life, sorry. But I was pastoring a little church and we planted it, we built a building. And then I saw these Tiananmen Square people. I saw them getting run over by a tank. You know, when they had CNN and they shown that up on, well, they still have CNN, when they shown up on the screen and I saw them getting run over. And I thought, Sue, we need to go and help those people. So for the next few years, we left the church and we gave. And you know what? Those were the most content, those were the most blessed time. We lived in a place where several kids, five kids, no heat. And one time we got arrested there. But you know what? But by sharing the gospel of Jesus on Easter, wow, that's today. We shared with 500 students. The next day they came and arrested me. Man, we hope that don't happen the next day after the resurrection. But here's what I want to say. But being a blessing and help was something that when I got off drugs and someone gave new life to me and gave Jesus to me, drugs, to keep me off it, I got to do something for God. I got to have purpose. I want to help someone. That's what keeps you. And I'm sorry for going long. It's their fault. They had this. I want you to see that 60-year video. I'm inspired by that, so I'm sorry about that. But listen, it's about the Great Commission. It's about, listen, we may not be the largest or whatever, but we can do something for God. Listen, your ministry is welcome here. Find what God wants for you to do. Maybe God wants you. Maybe we should send a team to Honduras. We used to do this on a regular. Maybe we need to help someone. Maybe we need to go to the city of Chicago. All I'm saying, maybe we need to go to the nursing homes around here in Arlington Heights. and give some elderly that lost their husband or wife and visit them and sing Amazing Grace on a Sunday, and where they think, wow, and you give them a cup of cold water. All I'm saying, my brother, my sister, it's about the Great Commission. Jesus talked about the resurrection. He said, now go. He didn't stop there. Your resurrection is about the Great Commission. It's about you taking something over to the neighbor. It's about you somehow helping and sharing your faith. We're living in a day, and I am done. We're living where Jesus is not supposed to be popular today. They say Christianity is at its lowest that it's ever been in the affairs of our nation. They say that less people will be going to church today than ever as far as percentages. We're living in where the media is telling you to be quiet. Don't share your faith. I think when it gets darker, we need to shine brighter. I think when it gets darker, listen. I remember when I got saved, I was going to school. You know, I went to the principal, could I share about what God did for me? Back then, I don't know. They said, sure. And I went into where I quit high school. I don't know why it wasn't a good role model for that. And then I shared with how God helped me through it. Can you do something for God? Can you go out on a limb for Him and go into all and make disciples? Where's the kids? Let the kids come forward. They're going to come here because we're in the benediction. Man, I'm sorry for being late. Some of you are visiting. You're never going to come back. If you have, no, we don't want to believe that. You're right. After you have some ham, you'll come back. But listen, you know, we took the kids to the Ascension Convention. And you know what I thought of? I said, man, this is a great group of kids. You know, God has a calling on one of them, two of them. God's going to do something with this group. You know what? You're a part of that. You know, as you're standing together, that's you. Without you, you can't have a youth group. Without you, you can't reach out to other people. I just want to say thank you for the calling that God has on your life. Amen. Let's bow our heads. Dear Jesus, we love you. We thank you. We're thankful for your goodness and your faithfulness. Listen, I'm going to give a quick thing, and we're going to be out of here in 2 minutes. Is there someone here, as we're all bowing our heads, is there someone here that say, I need Jesus? I need God in my life? If that's you, just quickly raise your hand. We're not going to ask you to come forward. We're just going to ask between you and God, you raise your hand. If you need God this morning, raise your hand. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Okay? Let's all pray this prayer together. Dear Jesus, I love you. I need you. Please forgive me. Come into my heart. Cleanse me. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, God, bless your people, I pray. Give them a great week. Fight their battles. Lord Jesus, bless your people, I pray. In Jesus' name, we love you. We thank you. Amen.